Ready. Good everybody. I'm going to start with a bit of an explanation about procedure as to what we're going to do this morning, because this morning we're starting a little differently. I would like to ask Marty, recognising Marty Siebert here and Hiranui Arangi, if you would open with the karakia for us, but the staff also wanting to sing the karakia, and councillors will know that some are good at singing and some are not. Then I wish to do my own a mihi from council to King in recognition of King Tuheitia's passing as well, and then we will get on to the apologies. So, Adi, would you do us the honours, please?
Kia ora nō tātou, a hori mō te rua, tēnā hoda. Tīmata I te karakia tīmatanga, anō tēnā kangihera. Mai te pai maunga, dara te pai. Mai te pai maunga, rāra te awaraki. Tēnei te wakapuri, kāwhi amai e tātahi mihi.
Nō whāna, karanga mai te toki.
Hui e, tā.
Kingi Tuheitia o tātou te wherowhero, the seventh. Hari atu rā ki te okio kinga roa. Moi mai rā, moi mai rā, moi mai rā e te ariki. E te kuini hau te ariki nui nā wai hono I te pō, no mai, hare mai, kia kaha, kia maia, kia manawa nui. And the translation for that is to King Tuheitia, farewell to your eternal rest place, rest well, noble leader. To the new queen, Ariki Nui, Nā Wai Hono I Te Pō, welcome, welcome. Be strong, be brave, and be steadfast. I need to just add also that whilst there is a lot of publicity, and rightly so, around King Tuheitia's passing and the ascension to of Te Ariki Nui and Nā Wai Hono I Te Pō. There is often a misconception that we are all bound by the Kingi Tāna movement. My iwi, and greatly represented here today, we'll see, and by Joel online, Ngāti Kaununu, there are many iwi who do not belong to part of the Kingi Tāna movement, but we acknowledge and pay respect and acknowledge the mana of that movement and of his position, and we will always do so. As Mark Solomon eloquently put it up at Turanga Waiwai, Ngāi Tahu reserves their own sovereignty themselves, but they respect and acknowledge the Kingi Tāna movement and what happened in that time that created, that gave cause and rise to the Kingi Tāna movement. So it is with pleasure and humility that on behalf of you all, acknowledge his passing and acknowledge his daughter's ascension to the king, to be the queen of the Kingi Tāna movement. So with that, nō mai haramai, haramai everybody, and haramai to all our young people I see here. We have a rather large turnout today, so I guess this reflects the interest in today's papers. So kicking off, apologies, we have one apology from Councillor Lou Newman. We can record that. Someone like to move apologies be accepted, please. Councillor Della, seconded by Councillor Williams. All in favour?
Aye.
Yes. Motion's carried. Conflicts of interest declaration. Are there any conflicts of interest declarations? Deputy Mayor.
Your Worship, I'd appreciate your opinion on a matter of perceived non-pecuniary bias. By Councillor Williams and Councillor Cherry Campbell have each made a statement via email and conducted themselves in a way which is unbecoming of an elected representative of their community by showing a predetermined view relating to the proposed adoption of the 2024 and 2034 LTP. Their statements and deliberate actions are as follows. On Sunday, 7th of July, Councillor Williams stated with his email, "We have to get this LTP adopted ASAP." On Sunday, the 7th of July, Councillor Cherry Campbell stated within her email, "We need to adopt our LTP as soon as possible." On Monday, the 8th of July, His Worship and I were informed of Councillor Williams and Councillor Cherry Campbell visiting other elected representatives, using language to try and coerce other elected representatives into voting to adopt the LTP. Both of the email statements contain predetermination by using the words "have to" and "need to." And I would ask His Worship to determine if there is a case of non-pecuniary bias, whereby the above statements, along with their clear breach of the code of conduct, as mentioned, indicates a predetermined decision before hearing or receiving all relevant information.
Thank you, Councillor Crittenden. Is there any comment? Williams.
I'm quite gobsmacked that you haven't chosen to discuss this with anybody prior to this meeting, Deputy Mayor Cretney. I stand by my actions always. The desire is to adopt this long-term plan as prudently as possible. I've been 25 years in local government. I've never been part of a council that's failed to adopt a long-term plan prior to the start of a financial year. We only have one job, and we are 3 months into a financial year and we still haven't struck a rate. Today, we're going to when the long-term plan becomes adopted. My desire always has been to get us together as often as necessary to discuss all the issues and options and get a result, get an outcome. His Worship was on the radio and in the media talking about all the problems that audit was finding, but we still weren't even together as a group to discuss those options. My desire in talking to anybody and everybody is to get us together, get us on the same page, and get us to do our job that we're elected to do.
Kilda.
So nothing has changed. If that's bias, well, I don't agree. I don't agree at all. I'm trying to do my job.
Anyone else with a comment?
I sit in exactly the same position as Dale. We've had numerous workshops, meetings, discussions. When the emails were sent on the Sunday, we were under the impression we were going to be getting a report confirming from Audit New Zealand that everything was okay with our LTP. That wasn't until Monday, Tuesday, whenever it was, that actually we found out that wasn't the case. Likewise, I hadn't been advised by either the Mayor or the Deputy Mayor or that there was any issues with the LTP prior to the emails coming out. Our job is to set an LTP every 3 years for a 10-year period. It is to set an annual plan. I do not believe that I have any conflicts of interest, and I think it's gobsmacking. Is that the word you used? Yeah. Yeah. Words fail me.
That's a lot.
I can't see any element of predetermination in anything that anybody did around that meeting. The everybody's objective was to have a meeting to pass the long-term plan. At that stage, I didn't think any of us knew that it didn't have a clean audit report. And I don't think that anybody would have, if we had had a meeting, would have wanted to pass a LTP without an audit report.
Kia ora. Wasn't going to be my first point of conversation in today's meeting, but I find it quite gobsmacking that a pecuniary or non-pecuniary interest as to a predetermined outcome is being discussed in this regard when I give thought to the last meeting I sat in where a recess was called, and at the time there was a 4-4 vote for a Māori board in which somebody was coerced to come back and change their vote on a predetermined outcome where that happened on re-adjourning the meeting and calling for a vote. So that sounds to me like if you're going to call this non-pecuniary interest and some type of bias, I think you've got you've got a roadmap of bias that happened well before this in regards to the Māori board vote.
So I'll thank you for your contribution.
Thank you.
But you're inaccurate and wrong. So that will disregard those comments. No one was coerced to change their vote at all. That assertion is totally false.
Is it?
And it will not be accepted at this table. So is there any other question, any other comments wish to be made? Because I will need to rule.
Point of order, but you've just said that that was inaccurate and false. I'd like to ask the man who changed his vote whether that he was coerced to do so.
We're not discussing that issue right now. We're discussing this conversation with respect to an assertion from...
To bias of predetermined votes.
So is there any on the point in discussion? Is there any other? Councillor Ailing?
It's been a few months now, so I'm just trying to remember the order of emails, but my recollection was that the CEO did inform us that there was a opinion that the audit were not able to approve our long-term plan, and then there were a flurry of emails from certain councillors saying we need to have this meeting, we need to adopt the long-term plan, which I think is the emails that Councillor Cretney is referring to. And I also was aware of the fact that there were certain councillors, namely Williams and Robin, Chair Campbell, who were visiting councillors trying to speed the process up and ensure that the vote was had at that point before the audit opinion had been given, which would mean that the council was adopting a long-term plan that had not been audited. So I was concerned at the time that a meeting was going to go ahead, and I think it's a valid conversation to be having.
Sorry, can I just respond to that? So just calling up the email from Cap on Saturday the 6th of July. Originally there was meant to be a meeting on the Monday, so yes, we were advised on the Saturday that, and I quote, "However, it is now clear we are unlikely to have an audit opinion in time to adopt our LTP at 9 a.m. on Monday as planned. We have to postpone the meeting for a third time. At this stage, I ask you all to pencil in Wednesday the 10th of July at 9 a.m. for the rescheduled extraordinary meeting, hopefully to adopt our LTP." So at that stage, when the emails were sent, that we were expecting that we wouldn't have it on the Monday and the meeting was rescheduled to the Wednesday, my intention was, regardless of what that was, we still needed to have a meeting around the table with all of the councillors to discuss the ways forward. And when I sent my email on the Sunday, it was bearing in mind that I was conscious that we were meant to be having a meeting that week. We were expecting the audit opinion.
Frank, Councillor Keller.
Thank you, Mayor Ron. Yeah, I'm a little bit astounded this has come up now. I'm trying to think back to July, and thank you, Councillor Cherry Campbell, for bringing that up. I also responded in a sense that my email said exactly the same thing, that we adopt the LTP and get it done as soon as possible. No dates, no predetermination, and that's all that was said. So as soon as possible is not a predetermination in my books. So, and I think as to having private little meetings between two or three councillors, there's nothing wrong with that. That's healthy. That's healthy debate. And it does happen between the mayor and deputy mayor or anyone on this council. So it's healthy debate, and I cannot see anything wrong with it. Okay, thank you.
Councillor Gillam, are you interested in responding to how you were approached by both councils?
I did get a visit, and I did agree that yes, we need to get the long-term plan sorted. Then I asked a few more questions after that, and maybe it's not prudent that we do it straight away. It could be something to be held back.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is where we have an issue, have a challenge, and I can only refer back. I need to cast my mind back to the decision that was made, and the justification of that decision was made to exclude Councillor Alien from the LTP deliberations. And I also will reflect my back to the inconsistencies, and this is one of the things that does vex me somewhat, is making sure that we are consistent with standing orders, we are consistent with our rulings, because only with consistency do people have confidence that council is functioning according to its standing orders and in a proper manner. It did strike me as strange at the time that a councillor should be ruled out completely from the deliberations and hearing process based on a comment that she had on a submission. I did reflect that the councillors who were most vexed about that were also present when the then mayor of this council voted on, not only spoke to an issue on the long-term plan, a proposal on the long-term plan, but voted on it where there was a clear pecuniary interest for the group which he was the chairman of, and that being the Five Town Trails and the budgetary allocation to it, and then used his casting vote to get it across the line. And it struck me then as a citizen of the town and a ratepayer that that was unusual. That was never highlighted and never drawn upon. And yet we come to this LTP and suddenly the rules around conflicts of interest are used very forcefully. At the time, I gave advice and said, Councillor Aileen had created a perception of bias, and that on those two matters, I could understand a decision being made, but it didn't go that far. It went further, and then we ended up in an embarrassing situation where Councillor Aileen had to be brought back in because it was determined that it was wrong to have excluded her from the entire process. I think what concerns me is that...
Point of order.
No, let me finish. I have the chair. What concerns me is that we have a trail of inconsistencies in decision-making, and there is a perception of bias. Councillor Williams, you were adamant in all of the conversations and hence your actions to drive forward that meeting and make it happen. And had it not been for Audit New Zealand pulling its any commitment to a draft audit opinion, that meeting would have gone ahead. And to say that you were not aware of the 42 questions actually doesn't reflect the email trails and doesn't reflect the briefings.
I'm sorry, that's not correct.
So I am left with a dilemma. I want this LTP to be seen, if it is deliberated on past today, as being a council decision which we're all bound by. And it troubles me that we have this moment in time where it is potentially possible that I could say there is a perception of predetermination. And a perception, and on that, the same ruling that was applied to Councillor Aileen should be applied today. So what am I to do? Well, what am I to do?
This is unprecedented, but still, if we're having the conversation, Your Worship, if you recall, as Councillor Cherry Campbell said, The meeting was rescheduled for Wednesday the 10th. You sent out an email on the Friday night to say you're not comfortable with that meeting going ahead. You wished it to be the 31st of July. I had contact, and I'm not naming names, I had contact that night to say, oh my gosh, why are we waiting another 3 weeks when we're already overdue for getting together to talk about the way forward? And in talking to Councillor Terry Campbell and standing orders, if more than four councillors were prepared to request a meeting, then standing orders said it happened. Six of the councillors around the table said over the course of the weekend their preference was to meet sooner rather than later. That's why Councillor Cherry Campbell and I spoke to the Chief Executive on Monday and said, please, can we have that meeting as scheduled on that Wednesday? The intent was, and yes, the audit's opinion didn't come in on the Tuesday, so that made it all null and void. But the intent was always to get your team around the table to share all the information that you claim to have and that people were talking about so that we could move forward to adopt a long-term plan as prudently as possible.
Thank you for your contribution. I think we're close to a wrap-up. Councillor Cretney, you're open to close.
Just in response to that, Councillor Lawrence actually sent an email through to his worship, the Mayor, saying he wanted to pause. That wasn't CC'd into everyone, and it didn't need to be. And Councillor Gallen actually wanted to pause. So I'm not sure where your numbers are to give you the majority, and the fact that if you want to have a push forward with a meeting, an extraordinary meeting, it needs to be in writing.
With the signatures.
You can't just request an extraordinary meeting.
If you wanted a serious conversation about this, you might have talked to all of us about what you were intending to do right now, and we could have actually managed it as a professional organisation.
We had an opportunity this morning in the Mayor's session.
Excuse me, call us down at the end of the table and I will come back to you. We'll find a question.
Sorry, Your Worship, just in response to that, I would have had the same response had I been given the opportunity to speak when I was kicked out of the meeting when we had our deliberations. There was no opportunity granted then to have had that conversation offline. It happened at the table. I was confronted in a meeting. I came with my reports ready to go to deliberations. And there was a very scripted response that was given by the chair, Robert Cherry Campbell, to exclude me from the meeting. I didn't have an opportunity to discuss it with any of you beforehand, and maybe then we could have avoided that situation. But it was all laid out on the table, so yeah, where we are.
So I am going to, and I will take the example that's been set before me. I believe there is a strong perception of non-pecuniary bias and predetermination on the part of two councillors, Councillor Williams and Councillor Terry Campbell. And on that basis, as has been said before, the chair has the prerogative and there is no vote. And so on that, both councillors will be debarred from participating in the LTP discussions later on in this meeting. Now, at this point, we can either proceed to go straight through the agenda and then people can leave while the LTP is done, or people can adjourn from the table at the time the LTP comes to discussion. No, Councillor Cherry Campbell, if I recall correctly, your words were there is no right of reply for Councillor Aileen. So the same will apply.
Reply. I just had a question.
This is insane, your words.
No, it's not.
Serious?
Can I just?
No, it's not.
I'd just like to ask.
Point of order.
I'd like to ask a question. It's not a right of reply.
Jesus Christ.
Please don't presume to know what I'm saying. I've actually had a question. As if you are going to exclude us from deliberations, as was offered to Councillor Aileen, when she put in quite a pertinent submission to our LTP process, if Councillor Williams and I are being excluded, then will we be offered the same courtesy that was offered to Councillor Aileen, although she didn't take it, to remain in the room and listen to the...
Yes, you will.
Thank you.
Yes, you will. So that is my determination, and we'll proceed with the agenda from here. And I thank those of you who have contributed. I respect your points of view. But to me, if I look through the, if I go back through what occurred, I am very clear in my head around the question of predetermination and the desire to pass the LTP without debate, without discussion, and without deliberation, because the wording in those emails was very, very clear.
Game, Your Worship. Well, I can't believe that you are in charge of accounts and are willing to steer us in this direction. Are you serious?
Councillor Williams, you've heard my... You did not challenge the chair of the hearings committee in this way, so if you challenge again, you'll be leaving immediately. Are you clear? Thank you. So, straight to item one on the agenda, forums. We have three items today. And so let's be starting first. We have Patrick McLean and Tina Day, you're here from Fincham Reserve and the Belvedere Hall Committee. You might want to bring another chair, but we have rooms.
Mm. And the first slide, the slide's coming up.
Oh. Turn up where you are, Joel. See you here today.
He's talking. Okay. I haven't got enough copies for everyone.
But anyway, what we're talking about today is the Belvedere Community Hall and its and the land it sits on. Over a year ago, greetings to the mayor and councillors. Over a year ago, the council decided to sell the land and the building, and we're now asking you to reverse that decision and instead repurpose the land as a conservation hotspot as part of the beginnings of a wildlife corridor from Fincham Reserve to the Tararua Forest Park. Who are we? Tina Day has been running the Belvedere Hall Committee for decades and is now very much a community organiser in that part of the world. I have been looking after organising the Fincham group of volunteers for about the last decade, and also much involved with Forest and Village. If you've got the diagram page in front of you, it's fairly hopeless without the overhead. Looking at this picture of Fincham Reserve, it says Carlton District, but if you look at it, you can see that the reserve is very, very much an island, completely isolated from any other conservation areas. This isolation has consequences. Over time, on isolated sites, the biodiversity, the numbers of species begins to decrease, and quite a lot of studies have shown this. So Fincham Reserve is now at risk with these declining species. We've noticed, next one. This is a little shrub called Helichrysum glomeratum, very few of it. And we've noticed recently that it's no longer present, that we are losing species from Fincham. Now, obviously we'll replant it, but the next slide. The one at the top there is an ornate skink. We've only seen one in the last 20 years, quite a spectacular animal, and it's nationally threatened. And even if it clings on at Fincham, over time it would evolve separately, a problem of genetic drift. Mm. So, and the lower part of the slide, we have all these native insects, 28 species of native bee. That's a bee on flax, on harakeke. And the surrounding farmland is just a food desert. And there's never been a study at Fensham of the variety of these insects, but they're there and they're vulnerable to species loss at Fensham due to isolation. So that's why we... looking for the idea of a wildlife corridor. Fensham is up there on the right. And the nearest point to the forest park is where those lines converge on the left. It's about 4Ks. It's a long way. Over time, the Fensham group and Frostenberg would like to establish or intend to establish a wildlife corridor from Fensham through the forest park so that the Fensham is no longer an isolated little enclave. Belvedere Hall is sort of on the way. It's just over 3Ks from the forest park and about 1.3 from Fensham. It's just a start, but we've got to start somewhere. So that's what we want. So in summary, turning the hall into a native forest reserve was a small but significant step to realising our ambition of a wildlife corridor. The Fensham Group and its Frostenberg will commit to planting eco-source native plants, weeding and pest control over the longer term. There are some issues, demolishing the hall, getting the power poles out, dropping the pines, etc. There's, you know, some work to be done. Athena has canvassed support among the local community for dealing with the above, all these issues. But everyone's busy carving right now. We'll have a meeting in the future, but there is very strong local support as Tina circulated the emails. So finally, the council support is requested for this proposal. And there's one more slide. So, Fensham's a great asset for the council and for Carterton. It shows up as number two on the list of things we like about Carterton, and the and number of visitors skyrocketed. It cost our CDC in the community nothing. You get it all for free. So how about returning the favour? And what is now Belvedere Hall was, after all, given to the council for use of the community hall. It seems it would be rather more seemly to repurpose it rather than sell it. Tina, you got anything?
Just canvassed the community and there's very strong support for that planting idea.
Okay.
It's quite a historic site in terms of memories in the community. And I spoke with Glenda and she did say that we were too far down the track to reverse it, but there was a possibility they could reverse the reserve decision just on the building and not on the land.
Right.
So that would be great. And leave it as a recreational reserve.
Well, that's the pick. We're done.
Joel.
Oh, tēnā koe, tēnā koutou. The Fensham group, really, I support your the work that you're doing to conserve our wildlife and green spaces. I'm just curious if you'd be open to engaging with mana whenua, hapū, tangata whenua groups to be able to support. We're obviously like-minded and
both
goal-driven.
Sure. I mean, yeah, sure, absolutely. I mean, the door's open. So we'll see how we go. That's right.
Hold on. Thank you so much. It's very lovely to have this report and for the time and the care that you've taken in noting that our, you know, almost extinct species as well. The mokomoko is something that is very close to the hearts of Hurunui Orangi Marae and our people. We have many sayings about it. And when it's found, it's an indicator that the taiao was in good state. And so we acknowledge that. My comment would be that reserve land in the Carterton district would have been Māori land that was taken well early on. That's why it got reserve status. So we would be very supportive as mana whenua in in supporting that ideal to retain and restore that land. I might note to the councillors that should any other reserve land come up that is not being used or for the purposes of the council, you may want to have first right of refusal in offering it back to the hapū and the iwi. In saying that, we fully support what you're doing there.
Thank you. Are there any other questions, Councillor Ayling?
My question was just, have you been in touch with Greater Wellington on this? This is
not yet. No, it's such a small area that I've chosen not to bother regional council or our head office yet.
Has the council had any? Sorry, my question. The historic societies, the Historic Places Trust went there. Is there any comeback on that? They went and assessed the building.
No. Okay. Donna, thank you very much for
your question. Ron, can I just ask one question? In fact, I should know this because I was on the hearings committee, but it didn't crop up. How big is a piece of land that
Ranges in all square metres?
How much?
1,300.
Okay. I had 1,400, but yeah, I'm fully right. Right. So it's very small, 1.4. Okay. And I just assumed, by the way, that all the councillors were familiar with the Fensham Reserve. Next time the council's sworn in, I'll invite you all on a conducted tour.
I'm very pleased. Thank you. Thank you very much. Next we have Marvin Pereira.
Marvin? Only just. Marvin, he's... Can I sit down here? Or?
Yeah. Thank you.
Kia ora. Good afternoon, everybody. I just say, coming as a group representing, my name is Marvin, and I'm a group of neighbors from Paris and Cornwall Road. So we have a little bit of a stressful situation about a solar farm or a beautiful name, Harmony, and a corporate come from England and just come to put polluting our views and stressing us very badly because we didn't have any chance to react, and they're moving very quickly. It's only it taking us into a step very stressful. And my main concern is our environment, our well-being, our pollution, and all the things we don't know. Okay, I'm going to read this very quickly. My name is Marvin. I live in 556 Perry Road, East of Takarata. My submission to you today is informing the Carterton District Council on the consenting of the Carterton solar development. I represent 25 properties who form the neighborhood of proposed Harmony Energy Solar Farm. 19 of these properties are invited parties under the COVID-19 Recovery Fast Track Consenting Act 2020, which is regulated by Environment Protection Authority, EPA. I have my neighbors, Helen Rodman and Marjan Conwell, and my friend Derek Mills, just to, and the rest of my neighbors as well, here with me today to assist me when answering any question. Yesterday, you received a letter we sent to the Minister of the Environment asking her to suspend the decision of the Harmony Energy Carterton application until the Environment Court has made his decision on the Far North Solar Farm application in November. I will take this letter to Honorable Penny Simon as read. We believe the neighborhood of the solar farm through the New Zealand deserve to have the same conditions of consent to protect the properties, meaning all properties. We also believe that solar farm developers who invest in renewable energy sector in New Zealand are entitled to have a level playing field when they apply for the resort consent. So no company have unfair advantage over another. We suggest that while you are working on the New Zealand Clean Energy and 107 Cornwall Road Resort Consent application, you ensure they are publicly notified so your ratepayers are fully consulted. In December last year in Southwest Arapa, FENO Advisory Group, known as SWWAG, presented here in the public forum advocacy for you to publicly notification to all solar farm consents. We are supporting the SWWAG with a petition which we advocate for a consistent national approach for the consenting of solar farms. We would like to display the petition in the libraries of the Warapa Library Service. We would like your political support for this to happen. Thank you for the opportunity to present our submission. We're now looking forward to answer your question.
Thank you, Mark. Are there any questions? And who is going to assist you?
Helen. Yeah. Come here, yeah.
We're all right.
You're out there.
Can I get hands?
Okay. Questions, councillor.
Marvin, if the Minister of Environment chooses not to suspend your or follow your request, what's your alternative?
First of all, I want to know your role, okay, and to represent us and to put this part and those the red pairs. Okay, I need your support. Okay, and this is the you need to be aware of environment. Okay, very important to us. And that's why you're a representative.
Oh, okay. Okay, there you go. I can add to that. I'm Marianne Cowgill from Perry's Road. So the 12 invited parties who commented on the draft conditions. We'll be asked to comment on the final decision, so we can do that. And whoever provides comments in response to the final decision has a right to appeal the final decision to the High Court on questions of law. So, that's...
Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Nothing? Thank you very much for your support. Oh, sorry.
Could I say something? So Marvin's correct. This has been extremely stressful on all the residents, the ratepayers that bounder this this project of Harmony Energy, this British company who has come in and is land grabbing basically areas around New Zealand, where their mantra, we feel, is profit over people. We are fortunate enough in our area to live next door to this, Perry's Bush. This is at the back of our properties. What Harmony Energy are trying to do is put in front of us an industrial park that will hinder our view of the foothills of the Tararuas, the terrorists themselves, what we are asking here of the Carterton District Council, if you would please support our bid to have the final decision, which is on Monday coming up, to be suspended until after the Greytown hearing, which is, what's that?
It's 11th of November. I think it's 11th of November.
Yeah. Who are in the same position as us. There are three solar farms proposed for the Wairarapa. And so if the decision could be held off until after the Greytown application has gone through, because they are in the position to be able to set a precedent for all of New Zealand, Wairarapa, we could be put on the map as being the area that sets the precedent for any other solar farms to be developed in New Zealand. At the moment, companies like, and one final thing, we do not benefit from any of that energy from this Carterton solar farm. It's all going to Auckland. It's been transmitted to Auckland. We get no benefit.
Time.
Thank you. We're signed. Thank you. So, look, thank you. Oh, we have run out of time. I'm sorry. Look, thank you very much for briefing us, Councillor Ware, of your concerns. and sort of to converse on later. Now, wait.
Email it.
Yep. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Include something about solar farm.
Samarama, I have you down as being a member of the public speaking at a public forum, but you're not today. You're here as the Hiranui Rangi representative participating in the meeting. So we will proceed beyond that.
Beyond my presentation?
Yeah, because you're not. Yeah, I'm just being informed you're here as the Hiranui Rangi representative.
No, there was a sign with my name on it, so I thought I would take the seat. Actually, we are not available to stay for the rest of the meeting. I've got my students here from Te Kirakaupapa for Māori o Wairarapa. We've just come from the parade for Te Reo Māori and Te Wiki o Te Reo Māori. So I actually have to leave. Yeah. I've just sat here because my name was there.
Okay. So look, for clarity, there is, and again, I keep coming back to standing orders for consistency and having been subjected to standing orders. Recently, I'm very conscious of our need to adhere and be seen, so I don't be seen to be favouring my whānau. Let's be clear about that.
I'm very clear about that, thank you.
So I'm talking to the wider.
Oh, sorry.
Not you. So look, I am going to ask, so the issue that has arisen is that when these people ask to be heard at public forum, standing orders requires them to A, give 24 hours notice, but to name the topic that they wish to speak to. They have done that and they've also submitted, and all the people who come to public forum do that. Mm-hmm. We didn't get that from you, Marama, but I'm going to seek the leave of the committee because you're here with all of our rangatahi. I'm going to seek the leave of the committee, our council, to see if we can set aside that particular issue for today as a one-off, hopefully not a precedent setting, otherwise then all these groups will do the same thing. Is there any objection to not have been able to present public forum despite having not advised us as to what the topic is? Is there any objection? You're not objecting.
No, I was going to clarify. I did advise, actually, and I was given an email responding that I had 5 minutes in the public forum. Mm. And in my discussion, I completely advised what it was going to be about. I sought leave as a public in the public forum to come and discuss the ongoing issue with Hiranui Rangi Marae and our representation.
They never got communicated for to me.
That's not my fault.
No, sorry. I understand that. So clearly you spoke to someone and you did advise them and they should have come through to us. So 5 minutes.
Thank you. Appreciate that. The Hiranui Rangi Marae representative is me. I've been given that mandate by the Hiranui Rangi Marae trustees, of which I'm a trustee. We have been trying since the unsuccessful bid for a Māori ward to re-engage with the Carterton District Council. We have made attempts, and the Carterton District Council staff, very wonderful staff, have reached out to us and offered to meet. And each time we've tried to do that, it's either been postponed or delayed and not responded to until just this week. So what I wanted to do is table this letter for all of you. There's Poppy there that can go around. This is our letter dated June the 12th, and I'm just going to quickly read it. Thank you. It says, Tēnā koe, Shiree. Shiree had reached out to us and offered us a date, as we'd been going back and forth, to find a date to meet to clarify our MOU and how we could re-engage and our relationship with Carterton District Council. So it says, Tēnā koe, Shiree, ngā mihi mata kuikui o ngā mata ariki o ti rā tēnei tauhou nei, suka ngā mate o tauwa te tangata ki te kāinga o te hunga mate, kore ki te whenua. I tēnei wā o te tauhou ka huki ngā māhara ki a rātou mā waiwai ngā kamo e te whakaro. And just as I read that, that's a mihi to those who have passed. And I want to thank those councillors who reached out to our family when our children's father was lost in the bush not so long ago and lost his life down the Mangatiriri Valley. That said, on behalf of Hiranui Rangi Marae Trust, we welcome the invitation to reconnect with the Carterton District Council. The Marae whānau are deeply disappointed that a majority of elected members chose to vote down the establishment of a Māori ward. This decision is disheartening and undermines our previous collective efforts to foster genuine partnership and equitable representation within our Rohe Pōtai. Our disappointment is compounded by the apparent disregard for the consultation process leading to this outcome. The lack of consideration for the voices of Māori demonstrates a concerning disregard for the principles of partnership, participation and protection outlined in Te Tiriti or Waitangi, so far agreed, unless David Seymour's view goes forward. Like you, we believe it's crucial to re-engage in negotiations regarding the memorandum of understanding between the Marae Trust and the Council. Revisiting and strengthening this agreement will facilitate improved collaboration and ensure that the interests and aspirations of local Māori and mana whenua of the Taratahi District are adequately represented and supported within local governance structures. Finally, we note that the Carterton District Council is out of step with its neighbouring councils in its failure to establish a Māori board. The council has likewise not supported the call from local Māori to oppose the proposed changes to re-establish the 5% threshold, which obviously now is in place, that forces a referendum on the matter. We look forward to meeting with the council and invite the elected members and the ELT to meet at Hiranui Rangi Marae. Cherie, thank you for sending the invitation on behalf of council. We will leave the details and the arrangements to be handled by our booking officer, who's our secretary, who's Dusty. I'd also like to note, I have a question as to coercion for the only member who was in the room at the time as to why you did change your vote that day. But I'd also likewise like to note that we have had members of our Marae who tell me they feel like they have been coerced and bullied into taking up this seat as a representative of our Marae when they do not have a mandate of our Marae Trust to do so. And I'm referring to our Uncle Gary Wata, and I see that you've noted his apologies for the last meeting. We as a Marae Trust have been discussing our relationship as mana whenua with the Carterton District Council and our local iwi since the walkout. I want to note again that you sit in a room that is named after our Marae. And so it is not proper that other members of our whānau community be grabbed on the way past the door and asked if they want to come and represent our interests here, because they do not. They haven't had the opportunity to discuss them, and they were absolutely apologetic to us at our trustee meeting and felt actually bullied and coerced to do so. So we'd like, Māori has been continued to sit on the risk insurance rōpū, and we have agreed for him to do that, and he has taken a steer from us, and he keeps us informed as we go through this process. So we would like to re-engage with the council. We've asked on many a time to do so. Only just last week we had an email from, on behalf of yourself, Mr. Mayor, to contact your private email and to attend our next hui as a hapū member. That came from your office, so we were a little bit dismayed as to whether that was an indication you wanted to renegotiate or not. We weren't sure. Or you're always open to come to a hapū hui. We have them at the same time every month. So that's up to you. However, that came from your office, so we weren't sure whether that was an invitation to re-engage with the Marae in an official manner or not. So two questions. One, not sure whether that was an invitation to re-engage with us. That would be great. We've tried on many occasions with your staff, and we feel like they've been a little bit stonewalled. Every time we try to make a meeting, we get asked, we get postponed. So we are keen to do it. We would like to have our voice around the table. But I also want to note that in the Local Government Act, it is incumbent on yourselves to consult with Māori. It's incumbent on yourselves to elevate the voice of Māori in decision-making. We feel that if you have a consultation process that asks Māori how they would like to be represented, and we clearly, over 150 of us in those consultation hui, said we would like to have a Māori ward as part of representation, we are a little distrusting of the whole process. If we have consultation, it feels like it's going to go nowhere because our voice is ignored. So we would like to actually sit around the table and talk about that and how we can elevate the voice of decision-making for Māori in this community.
Thank you, Mārama. Just been given the signal that time is up for us. Thank you for your presentation, and we'll be in touch.
Thank you. Would you like to respond to that question?
Sorry. Question.
So the invitation, I assume from quickly read this, that the invitation was for all elected members to come out. As an elected member, I didn't receive any invitation at all through the channels. So please do use my personal one in case I don't get forwarded stuff in future. That would be awesome.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Any other question?
Can I respond to Marama's question of me? Thank you, Marama. Just in response to why I changed my vote on the Māori wards, the position that council found itself in at that moment, I thought we needed a clear result to move forward. So as deputy mayor, I offered to change my vote to make it happen. As was confirmed later, a tie actually meant the status quo remained, so I didn't need to change my vote.
Kia ora.
And it's a decision that I'll always regret. Kia ora.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Everyone.
Our meeting's on the 25th. This week.
Thank you.
Kia ora, whānau. Kia ora. Okay.
Right, item. A piece of paper now.
Yeah.
Got a forum? A bit forum. Youth Council? Let's take a look at one. Youth Council views.
Atato. I am here presenting the views of the Youth Council on the agenda today. So the Youth Council met on Monday evening and went through the agenda as usual, like they normally do before a council meeting. They opted to take a deeper look at the adoption of the draft Wairarapa local alcohol policy and statement of proposal paper. The Youth Council supports the recommendation to adopt the draft policy, attachment one of your agenda, and statement proposal, attachment two, for consultation with the community, so option one in the agenda. The Youth Council advised that they will be submitting feedback via a formal submission on the policy when it goes out for public consultation, and they will provide a lot more detail around the thoughts and opinions on this when that is open for submission.
That's awesome. Any questions that could be directed indirectly back to the Youth Council? No? How many were in attendance?
I think there was a group this time. I think it was about 4 or 5. I can find out the exact numbers.
Yeah. Wonderful.
Great.
Which moves us on to item 6 on page 6, the confirmation of ordinary meeting held on 31st of July. I'll take it that the minutes have been read. Are there any questions before I move to the committed resolution? Any questions, comments? I then have someone move that the minutes of the ordinary council meet on
This is the ordinary council, not an extraordinary council meeting, isn't it?
We're looking at the ordinary council.
I'm item 7. I'm recorded as a voting against the flat point funding, which I have no recollection of doing, and I'm pretty sure I didn't. Might be some confusion because I did vote against the Norman Avenue expenditure.
Is that an amendment? Please note that amendment for Councillor Lawrence. Thank you. Are there any other points, inaccuracies that would need to be raised? No. So with that amendment for Councillor Lawrence's vote, Can I have someone move the minutes of the ordinary council meeting 31st July? Bruin, correct? Councillor Dallas, seconded by Councillor Gallen. All in favour? Against? Any abstentions? The motion is carried. Moving to 6.2. Minutes of the Hearings Committee held on 20th of August 24. I'll take it that the minutes have been moved by all. Are there any questions, points that are sort of suggested? There being none, can I have someone move that the Minutes of the Hearings Committee held on 20th of August 24 are true and correct? Councillor Lawrence, seconded by Councillor Ayling. All in favour? Against? Are there any abstentions? There be none, I declare the motion as carried. Thank you. 7.1, Destination Wairarapa.
Quarterly report.
Grab both those good chairs.
You go down that one. Sorry.
Sorry for the delay. It's been a long process. But are you okay?
Yes. Sorry, just I broke my hip playing netball. So yeah. Pins and plates now. Road to recovery, all good, but
she's not playing the game.
Not good at the airport.
No. I'll be setting off alarms left, right, and centre. There's a bit of a hassle at the moment. Kia ora, everyone. Thank you very much for having us to speak today. The report that you have before you was at the end of the last financial year, up until June. So it's a little bit out of date. In saying that, the general vibe of it is still relevant. As many of you know, we've had a particularly tough winter. Not just here in the Wairarapa, but nationally as well. Wellington is being reported in the news extensively recently, is suffering even more so. And because of our close proximity to Wellington and our reliance on that market, we too are feeling the effects. Wellingtonians spend outside of the region is down 6.1% year on year, which is an indicator of people who are stressed and are holding onto their finances. And as I mentioned, we are suffering for that as well. We're still seeing visitation to the region, as you would have all noted at the Carlton Deft Office in the weekend. People are still coming. They're coming over the hill. They're enjoying the sights and sounds of the Wairarapa. We're still relevant. We're still important to them. But while they have less disposable income, or they're nervous about their future disposable income, they're not staying the night and they're not putting their hands in the pockets quite so much as we would like them to. However, It is understandable. As Brad Olson noted recently, actually here at the Wairarapa Business Summit just a couple of months ago, Wellington and Wairarapa, the catchphrase is survived 25. I'm not a fan of sort of rhyming slogans like that, particularly when people are genuinely suffering. But it is apt, and that's what we're hanging out for. Thankfully, we have days like today when the Wairarapa turns it on, and actually we've got Tourism New Zealand in the region at the moment, and they were here last night hoping to do dark sky. As we all know, that wasn't going to happen. but they're here anyway, and they're experiencing what we have to offer, and today is a brilliant day, and the change in the seasons, which we are so strong about. We have definite seasons that people do really love coming and enjoying what we have here. So looking at the positive going forward, we are coming into spring. Interest rates are going down. Business confidence, although is subdued, it's perked up a little bit.
We'll see how that eventuates in terms of workforce, hiring, investment. But hopefully that will, as the sun starts to shine and things start to warm up, hopefully we'll see a bit of that warming up as well. We've got some fabulous spring events on. It's had the Daffodil Festival. You've got the Longbush Tulip Festival coming up. And those tulips are looking outstanding. The Bookshop Hop coming up. Yarns and Barns. We've got Space Week. How cool is that? Absolutely delighted and incredibly for championing the space opportunity that is in this region. And in fact, you've probably all seen it's wonderful brochure. It's out, and the posters around, and the fact that it lands in the school holidays is just a win-win. It's really exciting. Walking festival coming up as well. There's lots going out on some wonderful operators in the region. You know, Go Zone, school holidays again. Aunt Ginger's, you know, we were just in there for a coffee earlier and that's humming. It's just fantastic. There's some really good stuff to be proud of. I'm looking forward to, particularly in Carterton region. We have, as an organisation, at the beginning of this month, launched a campaign into our key target markets, which is the Lower North Island, about looking up. Things are looking up. And it's a campaign that looking to the positive, and the key component of it is to keep Wairarapa top of mind, drive people to our new website, which is phenomenally better than what the old one used to be, and we're stoked that it's had some really good positive feedback from locals and from visitors to the region. But it's also it's a tool for us to gain more names on our database so we can tell them more about all these events and fabulous things that we had. The best sort of result we've had from a campaign like this has been 4,000 entries. We hit that within the first week. It's resonating well with our target market. People are really excited. One of the key components of it is that the winner receives a number of vouchers from operators across the region, and they can either choose to use them themselves or gift them to somebody else who might be doing it tough. And that's really gone down exceptionally well. So, yes, we're surviving to 25. It's hard going for the operators out there. But, yes, also we've got to remain positive and look forward to the future.
Okay. The main thing I want to say is thank the council for supporting us. We really appreciate it. Without you, we just can't operate. Very, very clear. Thank you very much.
Well, I think, Robin, on that point, the credit has to go to the previous council, not necessarily this one. The boldness and the decisions that made to become part of the task guy.
That was very, very significant.
You know, it's
going to be the big future.
And to actually go to the extent of investing in the CapEx that was required to allow Carlton District to be accredited alongside South Wye. The previous council should be acknowledged for that. This council's just trying to carry on.
Thank you very much for doing so.
Yeah. But are there any questions, anybody around the table? Yes, Councillor Allen.
I just had one question. You were talking about the folks on the brain also, and I can understand your feelings around it. My thought was just with business confidence starting to go up slightly, what type of time frame do you imagine in your experience you'll start to see a trickle-on effect with the tourism sector?
It's a hard one. It comes down to, at the moment, there's a lot of operators who are working in their business because, you know, cash flow is not there. And so they're really head down, bum up, and just doing the hard mahi. When they're able to step back and perhaps employ some more people, whether it's full-time, part-time, that's when there's an indicator that things are starting to pick up. That's usually the first indicator. It's not big investment or anything like that or borrowing. It's feeling like they've got a bit more confidence to step back and work on their business rather than in it.
Yes, Councillor, I definitely meant.
Thanks for the fulsome report. I just had one question. I just wanted to try and get a poke for the District Council. Under the Dark Sky Steering Group, and you've listed the stakeholders we're missing.
Oh, you shouldn't be.
But
I
understand that. It's just if in the report.
My typo. It was not intentional at all.
Definitely Barbara.
Yeah. My apologies.
No, I looked in the newspaper. I thought the Garden District Council was in there.
Absolutely.
It's missing in the report. And I was just thinking, get that plug in there.
No, I
miss out on
future. No. I my apologies.
Are there any other councillors?
So there's one other question. You were discussing in here about the dark sky area, and then you're talking about other vineyards sort of in the north of the north of Carterton being part of this dark sky thing and making changes. Is that within the realm of possibility that the Masterton realm will become a dark sky accredited area?
Yeah.
Yes. Masterton was too busy.
What's that, sorry?
I would have thought the light pollution was too much in Masterton.
Well, they have committed to working towards achieving dark sky status.
Wow.
And so, you know, we could have the whole valley as a dark sky reserve.
They've committed considerable money.
Yeah.
I'm really serious about it.
Yeah, it's interesting.
So it's a supplementary to that. How's the conversations going with JNL?
That is at an infrastructure level that I, from a tourism perspective, we don't get involved in that.
I'm just thinking the glow.
Yeah.
That stands out.
Yes.
Right now.
Great
Okay. Anything else?
The 1 hour industrial area does have a lot of light pollution from JNL and from the Z petrol station.
Yeah, and I'm aware of it, but I'm not sure what the discussions are in order to address that.
I'm very aware because the location where we dim down and means looking at the sky, that is the pollutant in our view. Yeah, so. All right, no, thank you. Thank you very much, Shannon.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Sorry about the delay. Okay, so there being the report, there being the questions we feel like we should ask, I'd like to come to recommendations on page 42. Some like to move that we receive the report. Councillor Deputy Mayor and Councillor Della, all in favour?
Right.
Against? Abstentions? Motion's carried. Move that, would someone care to move that we, or note two, we agree that the initial proposal presentation arrangement we adopted without amendment of the final proposal of the District Council will comprise the Mayor and...
No, I'm
looking at the wrong paper, sorry.
Go back to page 20.
I'm looking at...
You're on.
That's true. I thought I had the one there. But go back to my page 20. I jumped right over, didn't I? Excuse me, suffering a little bit because of this face. Sorry, we have passed the resolution that needed to be passed. Thank you very much for that. Moving straight to 7.2, where I have jumped through to. Representation review final proposal.
Good afternoon, councillors. This is Bishop Luna. The representation review is in its final stages. I take it that the paper is read. The final proposal, after going through our hearings committee, is that we continue, or we have 8 councillors and mayor, that comprises of 9 elected members at large, and that there are no community boards established. The paper outlines some of the discussions and how we today. The next steps following a decision on this final proposal will be to publicly notify this decision and including the right of appeal under section 19N2C of the Local Electorate Act 2001. It's pretty much as we've been discussing. There are no changes from our initial proposal. And so I just ask if there are any further questions.
Councillor Ealing, please.
Sorry.
Thank you. My one question was, do you have a tally of how much this representation review has cost council in terms of time and resources? It's been a lengthy old process.
Off the top of my head, I don't, but we can certainly get that information. We can get that as an action item. It's been about a year and a half.
The only external cost has been with Elections NZ.
Yeah.
I seem to recall, no, I would be guessing and I wouldn't want to do that.
Yeah.
But it has, other than Elections NZ, it has been internal staff time.
Mm.
And and our publication, our media, you know, going out to print.
So we've had several workshops.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and as Jeff said, Election NZ, specialist advice.
Unfortunately, it's a requirement of legislation.
Yeah, I just think it's worth mentioning because I think all of us around the table would say it's been a long process, so many workshops discussing inch by inch getting this process ahead, and it still looks like we're a wee way off it actually being cemented as well, in terms of the 2025 people can make complaints and that kind of thing, that's what I mean. It's been a frustrating process, and it's something that we can't have much control over. I think the one thing worth noting, it was a point that I'd made at the time with Stephen Hill when he had his very first conversation here. I was disappointed that the Māori wards conversation and the first past the post STV discussion wasn't a point of the consultation. I think that should have been something that the broader community was consulted on. I think there would have been a far greater input and views that were shared if that had been included, but it wasn't part of the government's plan. But I think, yeah, that would be my one disappointment in this process. But otherwise, I think we've got to a good result.
Any other comments or questions?
Thank you for the work you've done on this. His Worship and I, down at local government conference, attended a workshop with Mayor Nick Smith, who's leading a look into the whole election process for local government. And one of the questions I asked was about the representation review and whether they would add that to the list, which they are considering because of the
I mean, I think as we explained at the beginning of this process, we had to go through every step of the process to demonstrate that we had correctly done that process, even though it seems repetitious at times. So,
yeah. Anyone else? Yeah. I might have the
observation.
Yeah, there we are. Sorry, Joe wasn't looking up.
Just a question. Sorry, just a question for Councillor Ayling. With your statement around consultation to public for Māori ward, is that just specific for Māori ward or for every seat? Would you like the community to have a say and whether a Māori seat's established only, or to have a say on every seat?
Every seat.
Well, I feel like we did have a say on the other seats. We just discussed if we were going to establish a rural ward, if we were going to have a mixed setup, or if we were going to have it at large. I think we, as a rule, we have consulted on all of the other issues. The Māori ward was kept aside, and I took issue with that. I didn't think that was fair to only have that as something that was decided through consultation with iwi and as a council. But I think the broader public missed out on having their voices heard, and actually it might have resulted in a different outcome.
Yeah, possibly. But also, I mean, if you, I'll just leave it there, but if you're going to have a consultation about things Māori, have it about everything. And I don't really, you might say that that's happening, but from our position, it's not. But I'll just leave that there. Thank you.
Thank you. Kia ora, Joel. Deputy Mayor Steve here. I agree with you, and I that is one thing that of why I've mentioned it would be great if Nick Smith and the group that are looking into the elections take on the representation review, because I think it should all be looked at the same time. The whole representation review should be considered as one thing, which would include the Māori wards, urban wards, rural wards, and at large and so forth.
And STV.
And STV.
I think we have a high degree of consensus around tables, and the conversation at LGNZ fell into that line as well, that we are being required to run three separate processes for what is essentially a democratic representation question and a method of by which councils are elected. It would just, I think there's a growing consensus that we would save a lot of money and a lot of time and get far better input if it was all done at the same time and the same umbrella. But look, that's fine. So we are on page 42, just correcting myself. Could I have someone move that we receive the report? Deputy Mayor, second it. Councillor Gallen, all in favour?
Aye.
Yes. Any abstentions? Motion's carried. Agrees the initial proposal for representation range, which we adopted without amendment as the final proposal, that Carterton District Council will comprise the Mayor and 8 councillors, all elected at large, and that no community boards are established. Would someone, a member, care to move, please? Councillor Ayling, seconded by Councillor Lawrence. All in favour?
Aye.
Against? Any abstentions? Motion is carried. Thank you. Third recommendation, notes that the final proposal will be publicly notified no later than 28 September 24 and be open for appeals for not less than 1 month. Out there yet. Someone to move, please. I can understand your reticence. Moved by the Deputy Mayor, seconded. Councillor Ayling. All in favour?
Aye.
Against? Any abstentions? The motion is carried. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. And next step is point 3. Adoption. I'm going to put it in the hands of the committee. Would you care to jump straight to 7.5 or just carry on? No, makes yourself feel relaxed. No. Carry on according to the agenda. Okay, so at this point, I will ask Councillors Williams and Councillor Chair Campbell to...
Worship, I just want to record my strongest possible...
Councillor Williams, you know that as highlighted by the Chair of the Hearings Committee, that is out of order. You don't have a right to apply.
You heard the majority of councillors do not agree a case for premeditation or bias. And this is a gross abuse of power.
You know it's on and you're once
you heard from that. You heard from your team, the majority do not support a case for premeditation.
As was highlighted, Councillor Williams, as was highlighted with the Chair of the Hearings Committee, the final determination.
So this is payback.
The Chair alone.
Yeah.
No,
payback.
It is
point of order.
Then you will be dismissed from the entire meeting if you continue with this behaviour.
Can I have my strongest possible objection recorded, please?
And can I add mine to that as well, please?
Thank you. You can leave the table, please. So, adoption of the Carterton District Long-Term Plan 2034. Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. Te mahiri ngā huru tangata. Our long-term plan 2024-34 is focused on resilience. Facing changes in our climate, communities, funding, central government directions, is important that we as council adopt to change, respond to change, deal with emergencies, take the hard knocks, get back up again and continue to deliver business as usual. In short, we need to be resilient. This plan delivers an increase in investment in our transportation and roading areas, our wastewater, our water supply, our waste management and recycling. We propose to renew aging equipment in our event centre. We propose to increase service levels in our libraries with self-service. And we're proposing to continue on with the refresh of the Wairarapa combined district plan. We're also going to stop doing some things. We're going to stop the development of the administration building. We're stopping the move of the depot down to Dalefield Road. And we're halting the majority of the investment in cycle trails and trails networks. While there's a lot to be proud of in this LTP for our district and our community, there's also no winners here. Our investment in core services is not nearly as much as we would like, or as some in our community expect. We would like to invest more. We would like to do more, but this plan is a plan of trade-offs. It's a melting pot of considered compromises. The cost of construction, especially in civil works, has gone up 37% in the last 3 years. Like our community, we've also faced increases in insurance, interest and energy costs. And like all of us, we're feeling the cost of living crisis. Council is no exception. The average rates rise in the first year of this LTP is 11.4%, or 10.77% after we take into account growth in the rating base. Across the first 3 years of the LTP, the average rates rise is around 10% per annum. I want to acknowledge the pain in these forecasts that will be affected and felt by our community. It'll be felt by you as councillors when dealing with the community. We've done our very, very best to limit the rate rises in this plan. I know some will disagree. I would also like to take the opportunity to apologise for the delay in bringing this LTP to you as council, to our community. We made some errors. Those errors were very late in the piece and were discovered after it was still possible to fix them and achieve our June deadline. These delays have impacted you as councillors. They've impacted our community. They've impacted our staff and our suppliers. And for this, I am sorry. Having said all of that, I'm confident the plan you have in front of you will drive the best path forward for Carterton, for our community, and for our people over the next few years, delivering an improved level of service and building our resilience to adapt to new challenges.
Thank you. Questions? Broad across the entire plan, we had the two vols and we've been through this considerably. So,
I just have one question, Jeff, and that's, I think I know the answer. So I'm always asking questions, I know the answers to. But the plan that ORIT have signed off is essentially the same as the one we discussed at length at a workshop a week ago.
On the 18th.
Yeah.
That, sorry, not the 18th, a week ago.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, that, any questions I have will sort it out then.
Give it to me.
Just those points that were raised at that meeting, there have been changes.
They've all been made. Yeah.
I've just got one question, and that's under the recommendations, under notes. And I just think the word discussions needs to be changed to decisions. Not sure if you agree with me. Notes, the long-term plan 2024-34 reflects the decisions made by council.
Oh, right. Yeah, thank you.
Discussion.
Yeah.
Just
on Councillor Steve's point, reiterate that the audit opinion is unmodified and unqualified. So that's a really good outcome.
And it was easy to get it like that.
Yeah.
On the day.
So a desire to speak.
I think it's on. I've got a few notes here that I just want to read out. But before that, so we say that as a clear audit.
Clean.
Yep.
The best
you can get.
Modified might be an emphasis of matter, so there might be something that they have picked up on, but you don't have to do anything. And a qualified would be there is something not really correct. So both of those are clear. There is nothing. Opinion.
Thank you. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
I've just wrote some notes and I wrote these this morning. So there's been 18 months of workshops, meetings in this plan, including the consultation program with a process with ratepayers. A consultation review with ratepayers, and only eight ratepayers responded. There were delays in receiving audit opinion with questions being raised and answers provided. I'm not an accountant, but I understand the overall LTP. There's been a lot of questions asked by the ratepayers through councillors, and I believe that they have all been answered by Karen and her team to the satisfaction of them. This LTP has been back and forth to Audit New Zealand with several auditors, accountants looking over it with a fine-tooth comb. It's been to the Officer of the Auditor General. I cannot see any reason that we councillors should not adopt the audited long-term plan. I'm not happy with the decision you, Mayor Ron, have made against majority to exclude councillors Williams and Cherry Campbell from being able to vote on the recommendations before us. The alternative to me is not the right option. So I see no reason why we shouldn't adopt the long-term plan, as the recommendations say. Okay.
Any other questions, comments? This is, and I would point out, Deanna, if the vote passes the LTP, we are all bound by collective responsibility, and we all support, regardless of whatever personal is. This is your last chance to have a say. And you will reflect your personal views around the different parts of the LTP that have been debated, and strongly so, on both sides. And I have to say both sides of the table, there's clear differences of opinion on certain parts of the LTP. And you people, councillors, are free to vote how they are expected to vote in line with what their thoughts are. But this is your moment to say your piece. Prior to a vote being taken, and I do acknowledge. Councillor Della, I will correct you. There is not a majority. I'll take out the two people who are under question. They are conflicted, so their votes, if they were to go to a vote, they would not count. What I see at the table is a split table, and it is half and half. So there is not a majority. That's an erroneous statement. So if we just park that off to one side, because the matter has been dealt with, and I don't wish it to be raised again, and we just carry on with this matter on the table. So if there are any comments or questions around the process, either questions or acknowledgements of support for the work that's been done, the floor is yours. Deputy Mayor.
Thanks, His Worship. I've written quite a series of notes. I just want to start. Thank you, Karen. Really appreciate that. The point we've got to, the fact that we had to go through the Audit New Zealand's delays, I think it's got us to a very good point. And I think the community should be thankful for that, because it's actually resulted in a considerable drop in the rates we were going out with. I just want to say that I found this latest LTP process extremely challenging in a number of different ways. Not the least of which is the proposed level of rates increase over the next 3 years. Deliberations provided us all with an opportunity to concentrate on core business and remove any unnecessary spending in support of what our ratepayers were going through in the cost of living crisis. During deliberations and questioning of the inclusion of several items, it was quite obvious that some members were, I can put it, subservient to management, and we're oblivious to our community's desire to minimise potential rate rises. Some elected representatives even chose to try and undermine the process by coercing others with rhetoric that supported their push for the LTP to be adopted as soon as possible, even though Audit New Zealand had found significant issues within the financials, and even though our mayor had communicated his preference to pause immediately, which should have some quite high standing with us all around this table. Those members who showed a perceived bias, they're not obviously participating in this discussion. And I actually see what they were trying to do. That could have been extremely damaging for council to pass an inaccurate document and lead to quite an awkward situation with our community to explain afterwards. So disappointing for me, even when some of us elected representatives questioned the inclusion of a number of items, we were treated with disdain by other members around the table, saying that we've been working on this process for 18 months. If we wanted to make changes, we should have looked at the levels of service at the start of this process. Well, I find that ridiculous, because at that point in the process, we have no idea of what the rates rises are going to be. So I find that, those comments just crazy. So I believe that the process that we work through is actually flawed, and I'm pleased that our CE will be looking into the way that we have run this last process of this LTP. I still find it extremely disappointing that funding that was set aside for developing the Matarawa to Carterton Trail was reallocated into funding the design of the bridge across the Waihine River, because it was stated in the last LTP that the funding excluded bridges, and it's written there in black and white. I would like to suggest that governance should be provided a fairly accurate table of financials relating to business as usual right from the get-go, with a separate column that has estimations of anticipated costs of the rises in insurance and so forth right back at the beginning, and then exclude the items that we might be consulting on and have those aside, and as we choose to include or exclude, we can see how we're adding on the number as we go along, rather than we get to the point of having to choose this number and then we've got to try and go back and revisit those things. So I just see it as a we need to change the way we do things. But the last thing I want to say is I feel like we're consistently told the LTP is a moving feast by some around the table, with numbers forever changing. So in our community's best interests, I would rather be starting the process with a prawn cocktail, rather than jumping straight to a crayfish mornay. And my last thing is I'd like to add a recommendation to the recommendations that we have today. And this is a request for management. I'd like us to consider that council engages an independent person with the relevant experience to conduct an organisational review prior to any annual plan 2025-2026 workshops. So I'd like to move that recommendation is included, and I'm asking if there's a seconder.
Could you read that again? Probably Steve, sorry.
That council engages an independent person with the relevant experience to conduct an organisational review prior to any annual plan 2025-2026 workshops.
So that relates to the annual plan?
Yes.
I don't see how we can vote on that with Councillor Cherry Campbell and Councillor Williams not in a position to make a point of view.
I'll ask the chair for his boss. On that.
Well, the motion's been moved. Motion for a second.
Did we have a seconder?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
That's right.
Motion's moved and motion seconded, so there I am bound by procedure and protocol to carry that on, but I don't know.
Can we get a bit more explanation, please? Mm. Just so I can soak it up.
So that we, the whole of the organisation has looked into to see whether there could be, are we running everything to the most prudent that we can in the best interests of our community.
So that would make it easier than we've had this year.
It's just an overall look into the whole council.
I think the council has a right to that. I think I know that during the conversations during the LTP, this matter was raised around staffing levels and organisational review, and I know that their reference was made to other councils, other CEs had done that, and we consistently didn't go there. And then a bit of my gut says that I agree. I think the motion's on the table, so it has to be heard. Councillor, so the discussion's in the throw right now.
Yeah, discussion. Sorry. Thanks, Ron. I get where you're coming from, Steve. I get where you're coming from, but the last 18 months we've been going through the LTP and we have critiqued, I believe, every part of council operations. Now that we're in having to get an annual report out by, and I can't remember the date, by the end of next month, we're not going to have enough time to do that before then, what you're asking. We've only got a few weeks to do that. I'm just wondering whether it should not be held over to the new year and then looked at it in a more in-depth look, if you wish.
I was expecting it to be in the new year. As such.
Oh, okay.
It's not for the annual report, it's for the annual plan.
Annual plan.
Oh, the annual plan. Yeah. Annual report.
Which starts next year's
budget.
Excuse me.
I still don't think that we can vote on that. I do think, in terms of the annual plan, I have a couple of thoughts. One is that the government, I think, is about to take the four. What do you call them? Accountabilities away from so that means that the basis on which we are running the organisation will probably change. And as we all know, we're in some form or another, we're going to change the way we manage our water assets. Mm-hmm. So I think there's going to be a significant relook. Well, next year's plan is going to be, unfortunately, I think quite different from year two of the 10-year plan, which means that we spent 18 months doing an annual plan, which seems like a disproportionate effort.
Some comment, please.
Procedurally, Councillor Lawrence has raised a point of order. You need to rule on the point of order before the motion can proceed. So you may rule on the point of order, which may be that motion can't proceed, but you have to rule on the point of order before the motion can be voted on.
Right, thank you. I am inclined. I'm inclined to accept your point of order, Councillor Lawrence. And that is not to say that I don't have sympathy or empathy for the direction the councillor, the deputy mayor, and his concerns he's having. And I think also it's going to be inescapable that with the change of the wellbeings, change in the legislation, and the three and the waters question in October, we're going to be looking at the annual plan through a completely different lens. Yeah. But I do empathise with and understand the direction of the motion. So I would accept your point of order and let the motion lapse. Sorry, Deputy Mayor.
I don't disagree with the emphasis either. I think
we
need to look at things, but
I'm sorry.
Seemed a bit unfair.
We'll leave it there. Other questions, comments? Councillor Ailing.
Yeah, thank you. I think to start, I would say A big acknowledgement and a thanks to Jeff and Karen and the senior leadership team. I think there's been a huge amount of work and stress and pressure that has been on all of you to get this across the line, and the delays and life, it's all a lot to deal with. And so I acknowledge the role that you've had to do to get this across the line. My thoughts on the process and the document are not personal. They're not directed to any of you. It's just my personal opinion, but I acknowledge all the work that's gone into this. Today is probably the first time that I've come to council without having some thoughts really prepared ahead of time, because when I have, I've been ridiculed or accused of playing up to the media. So I thought I'd just speak off the cuff today and share my thoughts on the process, and you know, and ultimately the vote will be what it will be. And I am bound, as all of you are, to collective responsibility, and I will continue to work constructively with this council going forward. I think my first thought would be, when I thought about what I wanted to say today, was why did I stand for council? It wasn't because I didn't have enough on my plate. I'm a mum of two young kids. I have a vineyard. I have a husband who's travelling constantly. I've got a lot on, as we all do. I stood because I wanted to help advocate for the people in our community. I'm aware of the fact that there are so many people out there, it's been alluded to today, who are hurting, who are struggling to get to, you know, survive to 2025. And I hear their struggles and I see their fear and the lack of agency that they have in their life. And the fact that they feel that government's doing this and the supermarkets are doing that, insurance companies are doing that, and the rates are going up. And it's just another thing on their plate that they can't manage right now, and that they feel helpless and hopeless to do anything about. I stood for council because I felt like I had a duty to come to a place that I don't want to really be at to voice their concerns. I have tried to work as constructively as possible with my councillors to get this document to a place where I can support it. I'm really pleased with some of the changes that have been made. I think our CEO outlined some of the big changes that have been cut from this long-term plan. This isn't the giant fat long-term plan that I initially thought we were going to be passing. I was concerned that it was going to be more extravagant. This isn't an extravagant long-term plan. There is a focus on core infrastructure, and I'm really pleased by that. And I think that has been the direction this long-term plan has taken. My concern, and I echo the sentiments that Councillor Cretney just put forward, I think there are some overheads that need to be looked at. There are conversations that we need to have that I don't believe were had properly around the level and the scale of this council. I think there are cuts that could be made and should be made to run as seamlessly and as smoothly as we can. I think this long-term plan has been a long process and it has improved, but I'm still concerned that at the end of the day, we've got a rates increase over the next 3 years that is an average of 10% each year. Very hefty second year is looking really high. It's not at a level that I believe any of us should feel comfortable with. I think going back to the event centre when we all campaigned, we all said lower rates, we need to lower rates, people are hurting. And I feel personally responsible for the fact that I haven't been able to get this number lower to a point where I could champion it. But I'm bound by collective responsibility and the vote will be what it will be. But this isn't what we campaigned to do. I thought we'd be a council of change, and I don't feel like we've changed. I feel like there's been a lot of rubber stamping. There's been a lot of nodding along. And we put our earbuds in and we pretend we don't know what's being said outside of this room. Go onto the Carterton Notice Board page. We know that people are hurting. They want the rates to go down. We got that last email this morning from a ratepayer saying, please don't increase the rates any further. If you can, drop them. And I thought, well, the ship sailed a little bit. The document's been produced. But I just think that's the sentiment out there. And I think we're deaf to pretend that an increase of this level has the support of our ratepayers. And we are elected to represent them.
What's it going?
I tick a lot of boxes, Grace. I too. Anyway, I've written a few things here, which the hours of work the team have done, I appreciate. I know it's been circled stressful. Well done, guys. It's so difficult to please everybody.
Thanks again.
That's you.
No.
I'm good. Well, that's
good as a guess.
Yeah. I'm happy with who we are.
Okay, so then my closing comments would be, I want to acknowledge that this has been a very challenging exercise, and particularly for the finance team. And I want to acknowledge that there were those who totally disagreed with my expressed instruction that we delay that particular meeting. And then there were the games that went on. I think the tragedy that as people tried to force through, and I do need to remind people, if you're going to start quoting the Act to me, then follow it yourself. If we were to retro that paddock and go back, what was required was not a big phone call to me from the CEO apologising that he's saying he felt sorry that I'd lost control of my council, that he had the numbers. What I would have preferred is to have been presented with a letter, as per the Act, with all of the signatures of the councillors who wanted to go ahead with that meeting on the bottom of it. You need to understand that that decision has no validity under the Act anyway. So what people were trying to force through was actually contrary to the Act. So wherever people got their advice from, all I suggest is read the Act properly and follow it to the letter, and then you don't embarrass yourself. If you're going to play this game with me, make sure you've got your ducks in order. So that is the tragedy of this situation. We had the delays, and it was very clear to me that Audit New Zealand were never going to give an opinion. And it was very clear to me from discussions with the Auditor General, there were clear reasons why. I've got to congratulate Councillor Lawrence. It was your questions around the depreciation that actually sparked some people to thinking. And then, of course, there were all the other questions, something quite minor. It is a tragedy. The highlight of this to me is the way in which the finance team pulled together. And given the time through that extension and Jeff's final, the CE's final recommendation that we should go to the 18th of today, that gave people time to work through. And yes, it brought with it some difficulties for ratepayers and difficulties for the entire council, for the finance team in terms of how to handle, and the comms team, and how to handle the repercussions of a delayed LTP with people who just wanted to know what the rates were and to be able to make sure that their APs, direct debits, were all in order and that their payments were coming out and they wouldn't get hit with a big whack later on, which is something that's been managed, I think, very, very well. To go through that process, and as Karen, you said to those of us after that last workshop, your learnings, the things that you've learned along the way, to get a result that we've got, where not only are all the questions answered, but we come out with an unmodified, unqualified opinion from Audit New Zealand, is quite astonishing. And I can't congratulate the finance team more. I think you've done a sterling job to get us to that point. Clearly there are lessons learned. Clearly there are systemic issues, and the CE has spoken to us about that, and those will have to be looked at. I would signal without that I have had an offer from the Auditor General's office to conduct for us an independent post-mortem so that we can have a clear view as to where we went wrong and what we can learn from that and how we can go forward. And I mean to take that offer up because I think sometimes fresh eyes on the outside looking and fed with the information of those of you who went through this process and who had to deal with it would be a very good thing for the credibility of Carterton going forward and for the next time you have to do this in 3 years' time. I also got to say, and we talked about this many, many times, the tragedy of what is a legislated requirement, such as a long-term plan, is the moment the long-term plan is passed and printed, it's out of date.
Ours will be more current than almost anybody else.
Probably out current, but just later. And it's been 3 months later, the privilege of some good NZTA decisions along the way. It would have been better to inform the document. But rushing and charging ahead, guns blazing, without taking care of the issues would not have been a very smart idea. I think that I'll come back to what I was saying. LTPs, to me, are in many ways a waste of time.
the way that we do them. To review them every 3 years is a waste of staff time and efforts and ratepayers' money. But we're tied by legislation and we must comply. The thing that vexes me most about LTPs is we set these rates and we mark them into the LTP for the next 10 years. And it can be said that those become an excuse immediately for future councils to not try harder to get rates increases down. We all know, and some of us have been around a long time, you'll never get rates down. You'll never get a decrease in rates. Infrastructure is it, the realities of infrastructure maintenance, and whether it's seal extensions, whether it's Wainoa water schemes, or whether it's capital investment and wastewater ponds or whatever, the costs are only ever going to go up. And anyone who campaigns and says, I'm going to get rates down, is not telling, is not being truthful, in my humble view personally. But the challenge is always on the rate of the increase. And we always look at affordability and we strive and we hard. There is a difference of opinion at this table. And I have been well advised by some at this table that it's a numbers game and it's all about numbers. I wished it wasn't. I wished we weren't organising block voting. I wished we weren't orchestrating, but that is the nature of politics. And so if out of that, it's bound to occur, as it has, that we have different views as to some of the appropriations, and we have voted such along the way. The bridge, one point in case. I will forever say that the appropriation of that money into that bridge is wasted money. But once we make a decision today, I'm bound by collective responsibility to support that decision that I voted against. I personally believe we should have conducted an organisational review. But let's look at that down the line, as signalled by others here today. I want to applaud council, and that includes all councillors, for the boldness on the Wainoa Water project. And continue. And even though the CE and the management team may not agree with the council, because their recommendation was that we not proceed, the majority of the council decided to proceed with the Wainoa project, and it is still here in the LTP, and it is proceeding. So I congratulate all of council for the boldness of that decision. Likewise, the boldness of the decision earlier on to purchase the farm, and that is all factored in, because in the long term, even though we won't necessarily own all those assets or have control over those assets, they will deliver an advantage to the future residents of the Carterton Township. And for that, I think I can, you all need congratulating. Am I happy with this LTP in all its respects? No, I'm not. Do I think, you know, would I have liked to have seen us doing better and get us down to 10%? Yes, I would have. But we are where we are after 18 months and more of long, hard work, and after an extended and protracted period of trying to get the final financials in order. And now we have to make a decision. And that decision binds all of us, regardless of how we might have felt, might feel about certain parts of it. So if there is no further commentary, no further questions, no further statements, my question is, are you ready to decide? I take that as a yes. So the first recommendation, that council receives a report. Someone like to move, please. Councillor Lawrence. Seconded. Fine. Deputy Mayor, I vote Councillor Della. All in favour?
Aye.
Aye.
Against? Any abstentions? Motion is carried. Notes the long-term plan 2434 reflects the decisions made by council at the deliberations meeting held on 29th of May 24, at which all councillors voted. Someone to move? Deputy Mayor. Seconded. Councillor Gallen. All in favour?
Aye.
Against? Any abstentions? The motion is carried. Recommendation 3 receives the audit report relating to the long-term plan 2434 pursuant to section 94(1) of the Local Government Act 2002. Someone to move, please. Councillor Lawrence, seconded Councillor Della. All in favour?
Aye.
Against? Abstentions? Motion is carried. Recommendation 4 adopts the following consultation, the race remission and postponement policies, including part 2 of the long-term plan 2434. Someone to move, please. Deputy Mayor, Councillor Gallen seconding. All in favour?
Aye.
Against? Any abstentions? One abstention. You wish that to be recorded?
Yeah, thanks.
Councillor Aileen has abstained. The motion is carried.
That's the rates remission and...
That's the rates remission and postponement policies.
Is it not tied with the next item?
No. Five, adopts the audited long-term plan 2434 Mahare Ere Ngāhurutanga in attachment 1 part 1 and attachment part 2, attachment 2 part 2 pursuant to section 93 of the Local Government Act. Someone to move, please. Councillor Della, seconded Councillor Lawrence. All in favour?
Aye.
Against? Councillor Aileen, you wish it recorded?
Yes, please.
Thank you. Any abstentions? There are none. The motion is carried. Recommendation 6, delegates authority to the Chief Executive to approve editorial changes prior to the public. I wish to make a slight change to that recommendation in consultation with the Mayor. Has anyone got an objection to that? So the motion to read, delegates authority to the Chief Executive in consultation with the Mayor to approve editorial changes prior to the publication of the long-term plan 2434 document. Someone to move, please. Deputy Mayor, seconded. Councillor Lawrence first. All in favour? I saw you look. All in favour?
Aye.
Against? Abstentions? The motion is carried. As reworded. Thank you, Robin. Recommendation 7 notes that the final long-term plan 2434 will be published within 1 month of its adoption. Someone to move, please. Councillor Gallen seconded. Councillor Lawrence, all in favour?
Aye.
Against? There are none. Abstentions? There are none. Motion is carried. I'd just like to note that those motions were carried unanimously. Oh, sorry, except for the two. There were two.
Number 5.
Can you note those that were carried unanimously were unanimous?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay. So, thank you very much. The very end of that item, your team. Well done and thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Congratulations. Now we can move.
Your worship, it's been running for 2 hours. The next item is actually linked to the first item, so the rates resolutions. But it's adoption.
Can we do that?
We can do that after the 2 hours, absolutely. Okay. We're running for 2 hours.
We have a 2 hour break. Yep. 10 minutes.
What you need.
2:10. Everyone comfortable with that?
2:03.
Absolutely. I can't see out of one eye right now. Well done, everybody.
Thank you.
Well done.